So this is the last part of my presentation, Rules for Revolutionaries. And these are sort of my key learnings from having done this for a long time in companies big and small. So the first one is a rule I had created 3 years ago. Until recently, I was the director for research and analytics at Intuit. And so I'd done a presentation at eMetrics Summit 3 years ago, and I'd created this rule, the 1090 rule. And the goal for everyone, every single one of you in the room, if you're here and paying attention to me and not sleeping, the goal is you actually want to get lots of value from the implementation of analytics. And the rule that I had was if you had $100, spend $10 on the cost of the tool and professional services for the tool. And spend $90 of that on the people. The web is an extremely complex beast. There are more people on your website trying to do more weird things that will cause your data to look funny. It's really, really, really important that if you want to get serious about analytics, that you don't simply throw a tag on your website. Most tools use tags now. That you throw a tag and forget about it. You will need somebody intelligent who's going to analyze the data, who's going to understand your business, your goals, who can actually extract value. Because at the end of the day, tools are only a way of getting data. And I find that a lot of people underestimate the value of business acumen and common sense that you need to attack the data with. So no matter what web analytics tool you use, the differentiator for you between success and failure will actually be, well, maybe all of you. It's the investment that a company makes. I'm stunned that companies invest $1 million in a tool and they give it to the admin. It's not going to work. And it's not the fault of the tool. It's a damn good $1 million tool. I would love to have it. It's the fault of the company for not investing in the people. The web is very complex, and it will remain so for now. It's very important that you actually invest in people who understand your businesses and can analyze the data. The next rule I have is that reporting is not analysis. A lot of people confuse these two things. And the interesting thing I find in my experience is that both of these activities take exactly the same amount of time. You could spend all your life doing reporting. You could spend all your life doing analysis. And you have to make a conscious choice about what you want to do. These are dead trees arriving at your desk. I love this animation. No. These are dead trees arriving at your desk, right? This is an actual Excel report that I was getting at that time, a couple of years ago. This is not even the whole of it. There is more. These are prettier dead trees. Old one. Sorry, Brett. If you actually want to get value from your data, and you have somebody in your team whose title says analyst, this is what they should be doing. Only 20% of the time spent doing reporting, because you can't get away from it. But you saw so many different ways today, early in my presentation, in which you can do data discovery, you can get context, you can segment. 80% of somebody's time, well, 70%, because I'm a very generous person, I give 10% of time for bathroom breaks. But the rest of the time for somebody whose title says analyst should actually be spent in doing analysis, unstructured analysis. You cannot expect to get massive insights from any analytics tool simply by implementing the tool. That is the start of your pain, not the end of it. The other one is to avoid the data quality trap. And the original title of this slide was Data Quality Sucks, Get Over It. But I thought it would be rude. One of the more interesting things about the web is it changes massively. The web is changing at the speed of light or even faster than that, if you can imagine it. And it is probably the most perfect medium to collect imperfect data. It has been deliberately built to screw with you. And the interesting thing is that there are many, many reasons why your data is not perfect and it's not going to tie. And if you spend time trying to figure that out, you will be a very unhappy person. But the interesting thing is the web still provides probably more data and more valuable data than any other medium on the face of this planet. Now, I am biased. A, I'm a web person. B, I'm standing at Google. But I can't believe that people take out ads in magazines. Again, remember, I am biased. Because ads in magazines, to me, is a faith-based initiative. Thanks to President Bush for that term. Because you say, a Fortune magazine gets 1 million subscriptions a year, and I will put my ad in it because I have a faith-based hunch that it will drive sales. Or I will do a quick market survey and ask my mom if she saw the ad. That's a faith-based initiative. On the web, you can do better. I'm stunned that people hold the web to a standard so much more higher than they hold the magazine ad, which is simply insane. So my recommendation to you, remember, I want you to take action. My recommendation to you is when you look at the data, assume a level of comfort with it. When I analyze data, and I know the web decently well, so I'll say, you know what? I have approximately 80% confidence in data, and I can go present to John. And John is a new person. He has always printed catalogs, and he knows nothing about the web. I'm not saying that. But John could look at the same piece of data, and he say, I have 40% confidence in the data. That's okay. Don't argue with him. That's the first thing. No matter what your level of comfort with the data, the nice thing is you can take a decision. Make a decision. Don't argue about confidence. I was giving a speech at a very big company last month, and I said, look, if I have 80% of the confidence of data and I come to speak to Rob, Rob is the CEO of this Fortune 10 company, Rob would say, whoa, let's go buy Google. 80% confidence in the data. But if he only had 40% of the confidence data, he might say, let's go buy Yahoo. Let's play with this for a little while. Let's make a less risky decision. The important thing is to make a decision. You might not want to send a rocket to the moon right away, but start assembling the engine. What I find most people do is they bicker and argue about the quality of the data. Remember, even with 10% confidence in a piece of data, you can make a decision. Trust me, you can. Then what you want to do over time is you want to take micro segments in your data. So you can say, I want everybody who comes to my website on the keyword Avinash sucks. And I will take that keyword traffic, just that, and over time I will try to understand why quality might be differing. And what will happen is over time, your confidence in the data will go up. It will move from 30 to 40, 50, 60, 70, 80%. Never going to get to 100% quality because it can't. That's the problem. And that's okay. At some point, we will all have RFID chips in our brains that will communicate with our web servers and give us great quality data. Until that day, make sure that you make decisions rather than worry about quality too much. Because a good friend of mine, he gave me this wonderful quote that I love. An educated mistake is better than no action at all. I am amazed at how often I forget this and amazed how often other people forget it. The next one that's very important, especially I understand that a lot of you come from large companies. It's very important if you want to create data-driven organizations that you actually have a process and a structure around data, around analysis, around taking action. Because most people say, and this actually happened to me when I first got to my prior company, people said, we have a report publishing schedule, and that's a process. And that's not a process. This is actually a graphic, and it represents the Six Sigma DMAIC process. Very simple. Define, measure, analyze, improve, control. Simple process, right? It's very important that for your web businesses, you actually figure out what a process is. In this case, an example is I want to improve the merchandising capabilities of my website. A lot of people think when you talk about process, it's flowcharts and complex things that take a billion years. It takes 15 minutes to do the slide. It is a PowerPoint slide. It tells the entire organization exactly how we behave in each step. Who is responsible for doing what in every single step? It levels the playing field. It creates a repeatable process. As you go back and look at your analysis, you look at your reports, you look at your dashboards, you look at what needs to happen in order to take a decision, to create a test, make sure that you put some level of process in place, because process scales. Ad hoc does not. This is the last rule I think I have, which is experiment or go home. And this is sort of a painful lesson I have learned over the last few years. And the lesson is that most web experiences are created by HIPPOs. And HIPPO is an acronym that stands for the highest paid person's opinion. Obviously, I have worked in a lot of companies. But you take all this data, you have all these brilliant insights and all this great understanding, and you walk into a room, and the person who gets the highest salary, no. I want a woman running in slow motion against a blue background. It doesn't matter what your data says. Since in my case, my HIPPO is worth $2 billion and pays my salary, the woman goes on the side. And it has been really hard, at least until the last sort of 18 months to 2 years, to actually figure out how to get around the HIPPO problem. Is how do you actually make decisions based on what your data is telling you, what your customers are telling you? And the interesting thing is HIPPOs come under all ways, shapes, and forms. Some HIPPOs are like that. Other HIPPOs are cuter. It is very, very common for me to interact with people in black turtlenecks with torn jeans. They are called creative directors. Are there any here? I hope not. But they puke over all your ideas. The nice thing about testing and experimentation, this is why I'm a huge fan of it, is it creates a democracy. You can now get a multivariate tool, an A-B testing tool, and you can say, if we have 8 great ideas about what this page should look like, or what kinds of promotions we should run, or what is the best creative for an AdWords ad, you get 4 lines and that's all you get. Test it. Why should you let your HIPPO decide what the customer experience, the promotion, the content, creative, bullets, font, what should it be? Why don't you simply test it? You can test it. Testing is faster, it's cheaper, and it helps your customer tell you what you should be doing. The more important thing I have learned about testing is that in most companies, 80% of the time, you are wrong about what your customers want. And the reason is really simple. Just because I work at Google and I use the Google search engine does not mean that I'm a customer of Google. I am too close to the company. You're too close to your company. Even if you use the software services of your company, even if you have work at American Express and you use the American Express Bank, it does not make you a customer representative at the company. You're too close to the company. The nice thing is you're going to be wrong. The wonderful thing about testing and experimentation is you can figure out how to be wrong quickly and efficiently. And that is an awesome thing. And you're going to hear later at the end of the day from Tom about all of the wonderful things you have at your disposal to do this. But when you go back to your offices, you should, every single person, every one of you, no matter what tool you use, should figure out what your testing strategy is. Because it will be the difference from you swimming in data and taking no action to simply throwing up experimentations and hypotheses on the website and let the action be taken for you by your customers. That's it. Thank you.